Discord's real-time communication service used a WebSocket bandwidth that was progressively consuming more resources and driving up costs estimated at hundreds of thousands of dollars. This was a big issue for the company until they discovered a way to reduce that by 40%. Their real-time communication is a service called Gateway, which provides instant updates to clients. Since 2017, Discord has been using Zlib compression for these gateway connections. Zlib, not this one. This one is a widely used data compression library that provides lossless compression. It is designed to be compact, fast, and portable, making it suitable for a variety of applications. It uses deflate compression algorithm, which combines LZ77 and Huffman coding. LZ77 compression works by maintaining a sliding window of size N of previously seen data and a look-ahead window of size M, for example with a window size of 8 and a look-ahead window size of 4. Initially, the window is an empty array, look-ahead contains ABCA. The algorithm searches for the longest match between the look-ahead window and the sliding window. In this case, there is no match, so we output A literal and we expand the window. The window now has A while the look-ahead is now BCAB. There's still no matches, so we output B and expand the window. Window is AB, look ahead is CABC, still no matches, we output C. Eventually, where the window has ABC and the look ahead of ABCA, we have found the longest match, which is ABC, so we output 33A. This refers to the offset to look back in the sliding window. The other three refers to how many characters to copy from that position, and the A is the next character after the copy. And then we continue to get this output. This really reminds me of lead code string compression question. Have you done this before? Huffman coding works by counting the frequency of each character in the input data. For example, 3A, 2B, 3C. Then create a priority queue where each node represents a character and its frequency. To build the Huffman tree, pick the two lowest frequency nodes and combine them into a new one with their frequencies added. Repeats until there's only one node left, root of the tree. To assign codes, we traverse the tree from the root to the leaves. Moving left assigns a 0 and moving right assigns a 1. So the encoding for this input would become this. Sliding window priority queue trees. Neatcode would be so proud of me right now. The combination of both LZ77's ability to reduce redundancy and Huffman's ability to efficiently encode symbols result in higher overall compression ratios than either technique could achieve alone. However, they began to take a look at zstandard because it's supposed to offer several promising advantages over Zlib, including higher compression ratio, which measures how much the size of data is reduced after compression. For example, if a 100 kilobytes file is compressed to 25 kilobytes, then the compression ratio would be 4 to 1. It also provides shorter compression times as well as dictionary support, which allows for preemptive exchange of information about compressed content. Dictionary compression is a technique where predefined sets of data is used to improve compression, especially for small or similar pieces of data. How it works: a dictionary is created from sample data that's representative of the data that you typically compress. This dictionary is shared between the compressor and the decompressor before the actual data compression begins. When compressing, the algorithm can reference pieces of the dictionary instead of encoding the full data, potentially achieving better compression. This can result in smaller compression sizes, especially for smaller messages or dataset with returning patterns. So they pushed the change on a Friday night to production to test. Just joking, didn't mean to cause PTSD here. Instead of applying the switch entirely on production, they decide to test against a very small subset of data. This is done by comparing a small percentage of traffic using both Zlib and zstandard and seeing how they fare with each other. They compare the compression ratios of various types of messages. The results were quite disappointing. For example, for user guild setting update messages, Zlib had a compression ratio of 13.95 while zstandard only achieved 12.26. They also looked at the average size compressed payload. For message create payloads, Zlib compressed them to around 250 bytes while zstandard resulted in over 750 bytes. These are really bad results and not what the team had anticipated at all. The team realized that a key difference between their Zlib and zstandard implementation was that Zlib was using streaming compression while zstandard wasn't. In streaming compression, the compressor maintains context across multiple messages, allowing it to optimize compression based on various scene data. Without this, the compressor would have to start fresh with each message, losing valuable historical context. Like me trying to recall someone's name when I meet them for the second time. Awkward. While zstandard supported streaming compression, Discord's gateway service was written in an Elixir, and they couldn't find any Elixir bindings that offer this functionality. There is this easy standard library, which is zstandard bindings for Erlang, but it only supported dictionary and not for streaming capabilities. To overcome this limitation, the team actually forked the repo and added streaming support. They later contributed back this enhancement to the original project. Truly a company of culture. After experimenting with streaming, they reran their experiment. The result improved quite a bit. For message create payload, the compression payload ratio increased from 6 to nearly 10. Average payload size decreased from 270 bytes to only 166 bytes, and the compression speed improved, with zstandard taking 45 microseconds per byte compared to Zlib's 100 microseconds. While analyzing dispatching sizes during zstandard Dart launch, the team noticed that the passive update we want message, which is a type of message that Discord sends to client to keep them updated about changes in the server even when the user isn't actively looking, accounted for over 35% of gateway bandwidth, despite representing only about 2% of the total dispatches. This was because they were sending way too much unnecessary information. This included complete lists of channels, members, and voice participants even for minor changes, which the client shouldn't really need each time. To fix this, Discord created passive update v2 and only sent the required information. This optimization reduced passive update usage from 35% to only 5% of the total gateway traffic, resulting in 20% reduction in overall cluster-wide bandwidth. The team also explored configuring zstandard's parameters to achieve better compression ratios. They focused on three key parameters: chain lock, hash lock, and window lock. These parameters offer trade-off between compression speed, memory usage, and compression ratio. After experimenting, they settled on slightly higher than default settings that provided improved compressions while also fitting comfortably within their gateway's node memory constraints. They also attempted to try to improve compression further using zstandard's dictionary, but the complexity outweighed the modest improvement. They also tried increasing the buffer size during off-peak that led to memory fragmentation issues and added additional complexity with limited benefits. Although initially planned for mobile users, the significant bandwidth improvements led Discord to implement zstandard for desktop users as well. This involved finding and integrating appropriate zstandard binding for each platform: Java for Android, Objective-C for iOS, they also had to write their own bindings, and Rust for desktop. Recognizing the potential risks of such a big change, Discord implemented the rollout behind a feature flag. This approach served three purposes: allow for quick rollback if issues arose, help them validate the results observed in testing, and enable monitoring and baseline metrics to ensure that changes weren't negatively impacting user experience. After all the changes, Discord reduced their gateway bandwidth by nearly 40%. This is a massive win and can probably save them hundreds of thousands of dollars a year. I hope the engineers get a really big bonus for this. What do you think of this optimization? I hope you were able to learn something new today, and as always, thank you so much for watching and see you in the next one.